Warning, do not listen to this podcast if hearing about freedom and liberty is not legal for you in your community. And if so, you should immediately move to a hipper community.
Welcome to the Freedom FEENS Podcast, a weekly web lab where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi cover the punk rockinist, hip-hopinist current events, as well as timeless universal truths about life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because there's no such thing as half-free. The Freedom FEENS Podcast, available from freedomfeens.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by Alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Welcome to the Vaporsmith's Freedom Hour with Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean.
Broadcasting from my windowless bunker.
And Neema Vedadi.
Go, go, Freedom Fiends!
Rolling.
So yeah,
What's up, Neema Vedadi?
What's up with you, Michael Dean? I'm just chilling, man. About to podcast. What's up with you?
Not a whole lot. Are you having problems with solar flares at all there?
Yeah, man, it's horrible. Like, it was like an EMP. I think the dirty Iranians set it off, and now all my electronics are shot forever. I'm speaking to you through a tin can.
No, but seriously, I've been having trouble with it. My cell phone wouldn't turn off today. I had to take the battery out to turn it off.
Huh. You think that's a solar flare induced?
I don't know. And another weird thing happened. You know, I don't want to be panicky and blaming stuff on it, but I've also been sleeping like 12 hours a day, which is unusual for me.
So the sun actually short-circuited you?
But DJ short-circuited her alarm clock. She has one of those, like, hyper-digital clocks that updates to, like, international atomic time through the radio waves, through the air.
Yeah.
Which is funky, because it's always 10 minutes off. Like, we were going to buy a new one anyway, you know, just a basic $10 digital clock with a battery, you know?
Right.
But she got up the other day, like, the static is really bad in Wyoming because the wind is horrible. I mean, the wind has been like 40 to 60 miles an hour pretty much nonstop for about 2 weeks, like the worst since we've been here.
Like
all the snow blew away. I don't know where it went, but it all blew away. And the other day I found this check in the yard that was like uncashed for $100, and I called the number on the check and she's like, oh, thanks for calling, but I already canceled that. My mother was trying to put it in the bank, and it blew out of her hand, and she told me where her bank was, and it's 5 blocks away.
Right.
You know, normally it would hit a house or something and just stick there in 5 blocks, but it must have got swept up into the air.
Oh, man, the wind in Wyoming is bad. I remember driving to the station once, and they were building this new bank, and it was just like the wood skeleton of it, and the wind just knocked the whole thing over after they had been doing construction for like 2 months.
I know, and that was a horrible day for somebody, but a good news day for you, right?
It was a good day.
Isn't that
for
how
me.
It works?
I was like, yes, another VOSAD. This is sweet.
I know. Doesn't being a reporter for mainstream media kind of make you into a vulture in that sense?
It totally does. Yep. I remember, and it did get to me sometimes, like the day I couldn't find a story and then I heard about some SWAT activity over the scanner and I went out and figured out it was some dude who totally got shot by the cops. And, you know, it was horrible. But at the same time, I was like, well, at least I got something.
Ugh.
You know, at least I got a story. It ended up being okay, though, because I was able to find his family. I was the only reporter to find his family and let them talk shit about the government killing their son, which was really awesome.
Good.
That was the only high point I can think of in my most recent news job.
So speaking of solar flares, DJ fried her alarm clock. She got up to turn it off the other day, and she said she felt and saw in the dark this giant static jump from her hand to the clock, and then the clock will not reset. We tried unplugging it, plugging it back in, pushing all the buttons on it, and it's like permanently stuck at 12 o'clock.
So she like put her hand out, and she saw a spark jump from her hand to the alarm
clock? She touched it to turn it off, and there was... Like, I guess, I don't know the exact instant. It must have been when she was, like, a millimeter away from it. But there was a jump, like an arc in the
dark.
Maybe
the solar flares are giving people mutant powers.
Maybe.
Right, just has the power to manipulate electricity now.
Maybe. Maybe we'll have the power to, like, keep the government away.
That would be an awesome power. That'd be my mutant power.
That would be an awesome Saturday morning cartoon.
Oh, yeah. What would the superhero be called? anti-government guy?
Nemano? Yeah.
Nemano, eh?
It'd be you, but like a Mexican.
And you'd be like the Professor X type character in the back room with all the electronic equipment, figuring everything out.
Yep.
I'd have a little earbud in my ear with a constant link to Michael Dean.
Speaking of superheroes, a real life superhero, our friend Ademo, is in trouble, and you should go to Cop Lock and read about him and talk about it if you have a podcast or a blog or even just on Facebook or to your friends. And if you can, make a donation to him on Cop Lock. He is seriously facing some insane amount of prison time for doing something that shouldn't be illegal at all. He was filming a cop who was beating up a kid, like, you know, under 18 kid at a high school.
Yeah.
And reported on it. And he's being charged with multiple counts of wiretapping.
Wiretapping. Yeah, I was just so upset when I saw those charges. I was like, okay, he's wiretapping? The government can do it and it's fine. But when we, film a public employee, that's supposed to be wiretapping.
Well, they have cameras everywhere and they film everything too. But, you know, we can't do it. We're not as smart as them.
So what kind of time is the demo facing?
I don't know. There's a good interview with him. The audio is not very great, but you can still hear what's going on. There's an interview with him at Disindoctrination Podcast this week.
Our good buddies over at Disindoctrination.
Yep. And all the details are there. So go check that out.
Worms.
So Google and Facebook are pulling a Netflix, which is what someone called it. You know how Netflix like totally
pissed everybody off.
Yeah, and then went back on it. I'm hoping they'll go back on this. But Facebook is doing a thing where, you know, they have that, some people have volunteered to do this thing where it's called Timeline, and it like drags up all your posts from the whole time you've been on Facebook and puts them on the front, and it's really hard to navigate. It looks really stupid. Well, they're going to make that mandatory for everybody in the next week or two.
Huh. Yeah, I've heard people saying they hate Timeline. I've never seen it. I mean, is it optional or it's always on the top of your page?
If you go to someone's site who has it, you'll know something's different. It looks like a blog almost. There's like a giant image across the top rectangularly, like one of their pictures, like a blog header. And then there's...
See, I don't mind that in a sense if it were you could toggle between that view, like timeline view. And yeah, but if they changed it to where you could, I would have no problem with that. I think that's a really good idea.
They're acting like the government. They're going to force it on you. Worse than that, though, Google is rolling out this thing in the next couple weeks to like compete with Facebook, I guess, to where they're totally changing their privacy settings and you can't opt out of it, to where like even if you only have a Gmail account, it's going to follow you on every website that you look at. I mean, I'm already seeing this somewhat. I'll be on some site that has nothing to do with Google and I'll get an ad for something I've looked at or searched on Google, you know?
Right.
But they're doing it to where like, if you check in with your phone or whatever, it's going to put your location for everyone to see and things like that. They're doing really horrible things and you can't opt out of it.
Right. And that is the horrible thing, is that you can't opt out. But just like with the Facebook thing, I think as an option, this is a really good idea. And that's why I think it's important for people to make that distinction. It's not like we don't like these things. Well, I think the timeline thing is great because often I'll go back and try to find somebody's post from a few days ago, you know, because I just saw it at work. And then when I finally have a little bit of time to myself, I want to go back and look at it. And sometimes it's hard to find. So a historical record of that, if it's an option, I think is a great idea.
Yeah.
And maybe that's where competition comes in. I mean, we've gotten to the point where, we need to realize, hey, there's just two big players in the game right now. Maybe there's a market opportunity for somebody to go offer these similar features, but do it optionally.
I know. It's kind of weird. It's kind of like Facebook and Google almost have monopolies. I mean, not quite. You know, the thing with Google, like I'm doing SEO, studying SEO stuff right now, and it's like there are like 100 other search engines. I mean, there's way more than that. There's like 100 other search engines that all added up have about as much weight as Google. You know, it's a long tail thing, but it's like, you know, it's 100 other ones. And Facebook has competitors. I mean, one of them is Google Plus, but
right. Well, see, it's not a monopoly because they're not forcing it. Somebody could come into the game right now. They're just on top of it. But if they start slipping, like doing this kind of stuff you're talking about, then it's time to rethink and say, oh, maybe they're not flawless. Maybe they can't hold on to the number one spot or be so unopposed for so long.
Yeah.
I mean,
and you know, the internet is supposed to be a level playing field, but in a way it's not. It's like, I couldn't start a competing Google. I mean, to start a competing Google, you need money. You need a lot of startup money. You know, I couldn't just host it on my DreamHost VPS. You know, you need to have like banks of computers to do that. And you need to hire geeks fresh out of Stanford to do that.
Yeah. Well, that's why there's really no such thing as a level playing field. I mean, that's a myth. in anything, the one with the most resources is going to have a bigger advantage. And there's no way to get rid of that.
Well, you know, people make jokes, you know, people complain about capitalism and how it works and, you know, white guys sitting around dividing up the empire or whatever. But my friend that went to Harvard told me that Harvard actually has these mixers, you know, people that I haven't graduated yet, but are like in their last year there, like the law school
seniors,
The engineering school seniors, and like the business school seniors. Like those three schools will all have these mixers once a semester. And literally, like, fortunes are made with business models scribbled on napkins at those things.
Yeah.
And you know, guys scribble something on a napkin, have a handshake, and when they graduate, it's like they can go to a venture capitalist and say, we're a Harvard Law School grad, we're a Harvard Business School grad, and we're two Harvard Engineering School grads, and like someone will just give them $10 million on the spot.
Yeah.
It's not a good thing, it's not a bad thing, just something people should know about.
Exactly. But I think the point is, there's something to be said for having money, but if you can convince somebody to give you money because you've got such a great idea, then that's where you can, I guess, level the playing field, so to speak.
Yep. So you had a comment last week after we finished recording that I made notes that I thought was pretty funny. You had a comment about how at the debates, Ron Paul was correcting Rick Perry. Rick Perry was complaining about, and the Taliban wants to come over here and kill Americans. And Ron Paul corrected him and he said, no, Al-Qaeda wants to come over and kill Americans. Taliban just want us to stay off their property. And he got booed for that. And what did you say it reminded you of?
It reminded me of Idiocracy in the court when the guy's like, he starts to defend himself. It's not even that smart. It's just slightly intelligent. And everybody goes, he's a fag. He's talking like some kind of queer over there.
Because he can speak in complete sentences. Yeah, right. It was very reminiscent of that.
Fag. Yeah. The smarter you sound, the more we hate you kind of thing. Because you're not like us. And that's an important point because there was recently a study done on Obama's State of the Union addresses. And they were ranked at an 8th grade reading level. 8.4 to be exact. And you know, the average, I guess, for the previous 60 or so presidents was like 10.7th grade reading level. So either way, they're only speaking to the people that are, you know, stuck in that statist mindset.
Well, you know, actually, this is kind of funny. When you're doing analysis for SEO, there's various tools on the web that will analyze your website and make suggestions for SEO. And the computer can actually read your website enough to tell what the grade level of the writing on it is. And Freedom Fiends comes up at a 10th grade level, and one of the recommendations is simplify it for an 8th grade level.
You
get higher SEO for being dumber.
So maybe that was the decision behind Obama's thing. Maybe 8th grade is the optimum level right now for the American public.
It's kind of the lowest common denominator of people that probably vote, you know? And, you know, someone with a college level of education can understand 8th grade speech, but not vice versa. So they want to dumb it down. I mean,
that's true.
He basically got elected on hope and change. Like, and yes, we can.
Yep.
I mean, those are like kindergarten level bumper stickers.
Right. Sloganeering.
Yep.
Pretty much. Because the American public loves a good slogan. FreedomFeeds.com. 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 FreedomFeeds. FreedomFeeds.com. 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 FreedomFeeds. Freedom Fiends.
Speaking of Obama, we have talked about how the character Tom on Boondocks is based on him. And we didn't mention last time we were talking about Reno 911, Cedric Yarbrough, who's the black male
black
cop
guy
on Reno 911, is the voice of Tom on the Boondocks.
Right. And it's a hilarious example because it's basically Tom is also the horizontal enforcer in the show. He's a prosecutor, and they go into it in this one episode when you realize that Tom's number one fear in the world is getting anally raped. you know, exactly like what happens in prisons. So he works really hard so he can become a prosecutor. So he, A, will be less likely to ever be anally raped, but the trade-off is he has to send other people to be anally raped.
Yeah, there's actually a montage of him being over-abiding of the law throughout his life, and one of them is he's driving the speed limit when he's a younger man. He's driving his car, and he's driving the speed limit, and there's some old white lady in a car next to him said, "Get the f*** out of my way, asshole. You drive like a bitch." Like this 80-year-old woman passing him and yelling at him. Yep.
Good stuff.
There's a Reno 911 where they raid a kid's birthday party over copyright violation. Have you ever seen that one?
Probably. I can't recall the scene now, though.
It's for having it on. They're told that they have to go out and deal with trademark and copyright violations because the feds want them to. Mm-hmm. And this is like 5 years ago. They go to a kid's party where they see a pinata over the fence. It's Dora the Explorer, but it's not really Dora. It's like a lookalike.
Uh-huh.
And they call it Dora the Exploiter pinata. And they run in and they end up getting their asses kicked by the kids and chased out by a bunch of 10-year-olds. And then they go up on the hill and kind of look down on the valley and like, "This is not what I signed up to be a cop for, stomping little kids' birthday parties." But really, like, the kids stomp them. And he's like, "Yeah." One of them's like, "Yeah, I mean, I signed up to be a cop so I could, you know, carry a gun and occasionally shoot someone and get away with it."
Which guy says that? The guy with the mustache and the big cop glasses?
White guy with kind of reddish hair. He's not in the first, he's in the later seasons. He replaces the hot bimbo-y white chick.
Okay, yeah, I don't think I've seen much of the later seasons. How many seasons are there?
5 or 6. I've watched all of them on Netflix, and I'm starting over again.
Huh. I think I probably stopped watching after like 2 or 3. Not because I didn't want to, just because I didn't have cable anymore, and so it wasn't like there for
They're probably
taking.
On Hulu.
Yeah, you think?
Although a lot of times shows are only on one or the other, Hulu or Netflix.
Right, right. Unfortunately.
So we were talking about Fox last week, and I was saying I thought that they were litigious about copyright, and we were joking about they don't go after people because they want a stronger law to make it easier. I was channel flicking the other day, and I saw Fox for a second, and there was an ad on Fox that said, "Call your congressman and tell him to support stopping online piracy." You know, it was a pro-SOPA ad.
Uh-huh.
And it was paid for by the United States Chamber of Commerce. And I looked them up. Fox's parent company, News Corp, has donated at least $1 million to the United States Chamber of Commerce.
Over how many years, though? Is that like a recent thing?
That was a recent, like $1 million at once. So I was right when I said Fox is pro-SOPA, probably.
I would imagine it. I mean, I would imagine most of the big media players are. I mean, that's sort of who lobbied for the bill in the first place, isn't it?
Well, it was Hollywood and, I mean, I heard more about Hollywood, about record companies and movie companies, but
it's people who make money off of the old business model. Just because the internet has obliterated the money-making or of their old business model, I mean, they're trying to hold on to the status quo, and the only way they can think to do that at this point is to use the government guns, which is completely despicable and not free market in any kind of sense.
Some guy I know on Facebook was really proud of having written an angry letter to his senator protesting his senator being pro-SOPA, and his senator is John McCain. And I said, you know, nice effort, but writing these guys is like the slave saying, "Master, can you please not whip me as hard," and probably as effective. And he got all defensive about it and talked about his duty to participate in the process. And I'm like,
The democratic process. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Like, people love that.
I'm like, I like you because you're an anarchist in the making. Give it 2 years. You know, he got all defensive again. And I said, besides, right, you know, John McCain, I mean, first of all, he's backed by Hollywood money. Secondly, his understanding of the internet is such that if he called the internet a series of tubes, it would be a vast improvement on his understanding of the internet. And then the guy got even more patriotic and I blocked him.
You blocked him? Oh, see, you should have kept him on. We got to take these people who are confused. Like you said, you know, maybe he's a budding anarchist if we could change
him. Yeah, but you know, he's one of those people that posts on my wall all the time. You know, so he's kind of spammy with his righteous indignation.
I see.
Yep.
I had a similar exchange on Facebook about SOPA too, where somebody was so excited about people going through the democratic process and hopeful that, you know, the wiki thing and the Google black tape thing would work to stop SOPA. I took issue with the whole democratic process thing because I feel like there's so much more we could be putting our energy towards than focusing on this.
Well, an interesting thing, I know somebody personally in person, not just on the internet, who's very anti-SOPA, but he's not libertarian in anything else. He's not up about rights for anything else.
Yeah.
But he's really against SOPA because he runs a site that reviews video games. He's one of the founders of this site. And
okay.
a lot of what they do is they have like screenshots and like video captures of playing different parts of the game. And SOPA would just, you know, he'd be one of the first sites they'd shut down, even though he's not pirating anything.
Right.
But he's putting up screenshots and video shots without permission. So he's like really adamant about this. And I'm thinking like, why not be adamant about everything?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's the problem. And that's sort of what we address in Guns and Weed is you need to be willing and ready to fight for and advocate for everybody's freedom, not just when it infringes on your own freedom.
You know, a real like light bulb moment for me was when I was reading about, you know, like 3 years ago, reading something about Boston Tea Party. It was him basically saying, like, I don't feel comfortable around homosexuals. I don't have any friends that are homosexuals. I don't want them to be in my life, but I'm adamant that they should be able to marry. And I was like, okay, that's walking his talk, you know?
And not only that, but see, the freedom position allows you to be honest and not lie about it and try to be politically correct. I mean, how many Republicans do you think hate gay people but would never come out and say it? You know, public figures. They can't go out and say things like that, but they probably feel that way.
What Boston said was like, openly, adamantly, I don't like these people and I don't feel comfortable. No, more, it's more he doesn't feel comfortable around them, but more open to they should have the rights everyone has.
Exactly, which is the important distinction. When you allow people to disagree with you but do what they want, then it doesn't matter if you disagree with them. You can come out and say, hey, I don't agree with this lifestyle, but do whatever you want.
That's what the Guns and Weed movie is about, you know, that the gun people and the weed people should support each other's rights, really.
Of course, but it's more broad than that, too, because it's everybody should support everybody Everything. Else's freedom.
Yeah, but it's a starting point for people who aren't nearly that far along the line yet.
That's true.
I mean, that movie speaks to a lot of different levels at the same time, which is hard to do, but we made it work.
Mm-hmm. But don't take our word for it.
Yeah.
Go and buy it.
Yep. So, got some good news here. You probably don't know this yet. Josh wrote us and said, just want to let you know that Freedom Fiends is being broadcast from a 100-watt transmitter in Alcona County, Michigan. Get the word out to everyone possible.
Nice.
I know.
All right.
I know.
Broadcasting from a bunker, I presume?
Probably from a flying airplane.
All right.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the road to freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
Freedom Fiends, anti-war, pro-gun. New show on the Micro Effect Radio Network, Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Freedom Fiends, Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi's fun and feisty weekly chat about constitutional, libertarian, minarchist, and anarchist issues, abuse of authority by police, the war on drugs, the war on guns, self-defense, states' rights, natural rights, Austrian economics, DIY art, low-budget filmmaking, digital recording, activism, rock and roll, and more. Freedom Fiends. Saturdays from 2 to 5 p.m. Pacific Time. Learn more about The Micro Effect at themicroeffect.com.
What does freedom mean? Tune in to LRN.FM to find out. LRN.FM is the Liberty Radio Network, a collection of live talk radio and podcasts, all coming from a principled pro-liberty perspective. LRN.FM show hosts aren't left, right, or conspiracy kooks. You can tune in 24/7 to LRN.FM via your phone, computer, satellite, and more. Listen free anytime at LRN.FM. That's LRN.FM.
And now, some corporate whoring for one of our favorite products.
Hi, I'm Neema Vedadi from the Freedom Fiends podcast, and I'm excited about Vaporsmith's electronic cigarettes. I dig the taste, and I dig the freedom to vape anywhere the nanny staters would wet their pants if I smoked.
Howdy, I'm Michael Dean of the Freedom Fiends, and I love Vaporsmith's. I smoked 3 packs of tobacco cigarettes a day for decades, but now I'm only using Vaporsmith's. I love the flavors, I don't smell like smoke, and I save money, so I have more to spend on ammo and treats for my kiddies.
Vaporsmith's e-cigs revolutionize nicotine ingestion by bringing it into the 21st century. With Vaporsmith's, you'll enjoy all the invigorating nicotine with none of the nasty smoke. Vaporsmith's are clean, efficient, and tasty. Available in 4 strengths and 10 delicious flavors. Reds, classics, Turkish, menthol, strawberry, cherry, vanilla, coffee, minty mint, and cloves. Go to Vaporsmiths.com. Use coupon code FREEDOMFIEND to get 25% off your order. This is a limited time offer. Vaporsmiths.com is run by a liberty-loving entrepreneur, not some subsidized tax-eater conglomerate. Vaporsmiths at Vaporsmiths.com. Vaporsmiths. I'm enjoying one right now.
So speaking of Vaporsmith's, there's now a Vaporsmith's blog that I've set up at vaporsmiths.net. And if you go there, there is a contest where you could win Vaporsmith's products, and you don't even have to purchase them. And so go to vaporsmiths.net. I'll link it on the site. And you can win some cool stuff.
Awesome. So what do you got to do? You got to review Vaporsmith's in a video review?
Or if you've never tried them, make a commercial for them based on the website. You don't have to... to be a member.
Fair enough. Are we allowed to make entries?
No.
Okay, then.
No, but you've got some headed to you right now. They're in your state, and they should be at your house today or tomorrow.
Awesome. I always welcome my shipment of nicotine.
Yep.
Awesome. An idea for a new segment. I haven't pitched this to you yet, but you tell me what you think about it. What if once an episode we do the slogan shout out and we could read off our favorite liberty oriented quotes from the week? That way we can give some shine to some other libertarian rock stars and, you know, bring you the best of what's going on in the liberty movement.
All right.
You like it?
I got one, and it ties in with SOPA. I was going to say this a few minutes ago. On Free Talk Live, I don't remember if it was Ian or Mark, but one of them said about all these people cheering that SOPA was supposedly defeated is this thing isn't gone, and it's going to come back, and it'll probably be a rider in next year's defense authorization bill, and it'll just pass.
Yep, yep, and nobody will notice it. Who said that?
It was either Mark or Ian. It was somebody on Free Talk Live.
Okay, okay. Good deal, good deal. That's our, congratulations, our first slogan shout-out right there.
Yep.
I had one, too. This is Christopher Mannion, I think I'm pronouncing that right, from the Lou Rockwell blog in response to the idea of Obama speaking to the 8th grade audience in his State of the Union addresses. He says, Holy O's audience is the uneducated voter, thanks to his allies in the government school unions, and his goal is making them resentful and envious while leaving them uneducated. Think Orwell's proles and Huxley's deltas. Get in line for your Soma.
Ooh, that ties in with so many things we've talked about.
I know. I thought it was like a whole 15 minutes of the podcast encapsulated in a sentence.
Well, you know, there's an email that I think I've mentioned before. I can't remember who it's attributed to. It's misattributed. It's actually a combination of things two people said, and I can't remember who they were, but it's misattributed to a third person. It's a viral email that it's what I call dad spam. It's something that old people send.
Usually stuff about Obama being a secret Muslim or not having a birth certificate.
Yeah, yeah. It's all about hating the Democrats, but you know, when the Republicans get back in, it'll all be about how great they are.
How weak liberals are and how they're a bunch of pussies.
I take it a lot more seriously if they hated everybody in these dad spams. But this one is actually really cogent. I mean, it starts with something I don't believe is true, that democracy is the best form of government. Well, maybe it is if there's going to be a government, but who needs a government? Yeah. What it goes on to say is that throughout history, all democracies have thrived for a little while and then fallen apart and dissolved after 200 or 300 years because incrementally people realize they can vote for a living instead of work for a living.
I love that. Yeah, that's very true. Yeah. I got this one dad spam that was basically it was a little girl. You know, it's like, this is written by a 12-year-old girl. Be impressed, you know, kind of thing. And she was going off on the welfare state, but only to the point of reform. She was saying, well, you know, if we're going to pay for you, then you can't have a big screen TV and we'll do daily inspections of your house to make sure you're not buying 20-inch rims and all this other stuff. And it was written by a dad who's old and wanted to do dad spam.
And wanted to spam. Yeah.
And, you know, we won't let you buy frozen pizzas with our food stamps anymore. Only 50-pound bags of rice.
These things are probably written by a paid staff at the, I would guess, at the American Chamber of Commerce or whatever it's called.
Yeah, they had an email to respond back to the original person because, you know, it was a chain letter kind of thing, you know, please respond back. And so I responded to the fake email, which was like anonymous 12-year-old girl.
At gmail.com.
Yeah, and I was just like, nice try, but we don't really need a welfare state at all, so get up off of it.
Well, isn't that part of the definition of a neocon, is a right-winger that believes in some welfare state?
I don't know if that's the definition of a neocon, but the definition of a neocon to me is a right winger or any winger who believes in the force and power of the state as the ultimate goal in life. And people need to be corralled in whatever way possible and lied to as long as it increases the power of the state. And they don't care whether that's internally, externally, domestically, in war, wherever.
Yeah, the thing that young people don't realize who don't study history at all is that the baseline of what the government does and how much intervention it has now is so huge compared to what it was 50 or 100 years ago.
Completely.
Or even when I was a kid.
I think it's unimaginable to even the most statist daydreamers like Trotsky and Marx that we would ever have a state this powerful.
And that they would have it so invisible, you know? I mean, I don't feel a gun at my head sitting right here in Wyoming looking out the window.
No, and people will think you're funny. People think it's weird that you say, you know, the government's just violence. They've always got a gun to your head. Once you explain it to them, if they get it, then they're like, yeah, but oh well, it's not that extreme.
I'm waiting for them to outlaw that kind of talk, like to make it illegal to talk about the non-aggression principle and make it illegal to talk about how taxes are enforced and laws are enforced at the barrel of gun.
But see, that's the thing, is sometimes they're slick enough to hide it from you. They're good at hiding the gun. They hide the gun of taxes with the withholding program, to where they make you think you're getting a nice check at the end of the year. Oh, here you go. I can't wait for my tax return so I can put a down payment on a new car.
Bush gave me $600. I'll vote for him.
Exactly. And so the way I think they're trying to de facto get rid of talk like this is through things like SOPA. And even if SOPA dies, then, you know, the inheritance of that, whatever comes next, they're going to try to get rid of talk like this in the back doorway with regulation, how they do everything.
You know, do you have another quote?
No, I don't. I was just throwing out an idea. Okay. I think what we should compile them through the week. And listeners, fiends, feel free, you know, send it to TalkBack, put it on our Facebooks. We'd like to have sort of a crowdsource element of it as well.
Yeah, I can segue off that, off the letter that said it's written by a little girl that isn't, into some other horizontal enforcement from when I was a kid. You ever seen a book or heard of a book called Go Ask Alice?
No. Although Lauryn Hill has a reference to it in a Fugees song. It was Go Ask Alice if you don't believe me. I get into visions like Stevie or something like that.
Well, Go Ask Alice is a book that the title comes from a Jefferson Airplane song about doing drugs that references Alice in Wonderland. So she could be referencing any of that. I mean, probably not the Jefferson Airplane.
Why not the Jefferson Airplane? That's racist.
I thought they're kind of the ultimate only white people like them kind of music.
The Fugees or Jefferson Airplane?
Jefferson Airplane.
Okay.
Go Ask Alice is a book from 1971 that I read when I was about 10 in probably 1974. It was a bestseller, and it's supposed to be the diary of a teenage girl who got into drugs and got into prostitution and overdosed on drugs. And supposedly her parents found the book and gave it to some writer who polished it up and published it as a cautionary example.
Okay. Like a drug PSA kind of thing.
Yeah. It was a really big best-selling novel. I mean, they made people read it in school, which is pretty bizarre because some of it makes drugs look really good and makes sex look really good, you know, until she dies. But it's been proven that this book was not written by a teenage girl. It was written by an adult woman named Beatrice Sparks, who's a Mormon who actually wrote a bunch of other cautionary books that were supposedly written by kids that weren't, like one about a kid who gets into Satanism and sacrifices his baby sister or something.
That makes a lot more sense.
This book, DJ and I were talking about it one day. We read it and it made us want to take drugs. And then I read an interview with Marilyn Manson where they said, "When did you start taking drugs?" And he's like, "They made us read this book in school called Go Ask Alice." And So I guess I wasn't the only person who had that. It had that
effect.
That's
great. That's great. Law of unintended consequences. Because their intention was, see, if you do these fun things, you'll face the consequences. Dun, dun, dun. But you just all you heard was, oh, these things are fun. I'm going to go do them.
Yeah, I think I stopped reading 2/3 of the way through it or something and went and found some drugs.
Nice.
Yeah, but it was some really like tricky horizontal enforcement. I mean, this was a book that like every concerned parent bought for their kids in the early 70s.
A good example of it not working, though. So, see, I get more scared at the horizontal enforcement that seems impenetrable. But, you know, this horizontal or attempt at horizontal enforcement actually made some people do drugs and then ideally made them doubt the status quo because they took the drugs, they thought it was fun, and maybe they didn't face the same...
Well, I wonder about those billboards all over Wyoming in this part of the country that have, you'll sell your little sister for crystal meth if you try it once. But the thing is, the actors and models in them are really good-looking people.
you want to be them?
Yeah. I mean, I wonder, damn it, someone's calling me. Go
Bastards.
Away. So I'm wondering... you know, if it has the unintended effect of doing the opposite with anybody. I'm just sick of paying for them. I mean, my taxes pay for them, and I don't think they do any good.
Yeah.
I don't want to pay for them.
Yeah.
They're really heinous and, like, violent and in-your-face and sexual, and it's like, I don't want to see that when I'm out driving. I mean, I think that whoever makes them should be charged with obscenity.
Yeah. Well, you know, I don't want to pay for anything that you're going to tax me for. And not only that, but yeah, I think that is important to note, though. And I'm not saying you shouldn't have said that, because I think it's important to note some of the disgusting things our money goes to. Because a lot of people, you know, they might think, well, at least I'm helping to pay for the roads or yada yada. But you're also paying for a bunch of horrendous stuff. Not only this, but, you know, you're paying for people to piss on
the
bodies,
war on drugs.
For the war on drugs, for flying robots that can incinerate people.
You know, actually, I read recently that the U.S. military now has stuff that's like beyond drones. They're like, can carry a payload as big as a pickup truck and fly in low space orbit.
Oh my God.
You know, basically I'm thinking like they decommissioned NASA. I don't think they did. I think it's just working for the military completely now.
I think it always was, in a sense.
I think so too.
And not only that, but I also think that that's an important reason that, you know, Republitrons suck NASA's dick so much. It's really just a big jobs program, but they get so wet over it.
It's a big patriotism program, too. I mean,
it's a dick measuring thing. That's what it used to. That's what it started out as.
You weren't alive in 1969 when we landed the man on the moon. And I don't doubt that we did. I'm not one of those people. I think we really did. But, you know, I was 5 years old and it was like my dad and I sat and watched it and we're just like loving it. Like, look what America's doing. This is so wonderful. And the whole country, the whole world watched it and went, wow, look what America's doing, you know. And that's how it was portrayed. Like, these guys were these huge heroes for doing this.
Yeah. Which I guess is, it would be a noble thing if it wasn't on force. And it sounds like something like that, where everybody was so on board with it, maybe you could have done it voluntarily.
Well, I'm going to totally take back my idea of Google should take care of defense, because they're pissing me off, forcing things on people that we don't want.
Well, see, I don't think your sentiment was ever, it should be Google. It was some company would take care of it and act like Google in the sense that, as Google was initially, which was very open source. And
Well, you know, it's funny, it's ironic, because their motto is do no evil. And now they're doing evil. And recently they were caught doing some really sleazy stuff overseas, of like a company they hired to do their work was calling up other companies and like billing them for inclusion in local Google stuff, which, you know, they're not supposed to do, but they did. And the joke that's been going around is, Google, don't be evil, outsource your evil.
Nice.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFeens.com.
So speaking of drones, did you read the latest in Iran not returning the drone?
Yeah, not only are they going to not return the drone, but they've turned it into toys and are selling awesome American drone toys in their stores.
And they've offered to send one to America.
Yes. as a gift. It's a goodwill thing.
It's a
there
gift.
You go. Yeah.
Yeah. So, you ever seen the movie Gran Torino?
No, you told me to watch it, but I have not had the time yet.
I'm going to make that a homework assignment to watch the movie Gran Torino that stars Clint Eastwood, and it's amazing, and it deals with a lot of racial issues, and it's amazing, and his go-to gun for home self-defense is not a pistol, it's not a shotgun, it's an M1 Grand, which I like.
So, I'm intrigued here, though. These race issues, I don't know, I never really feel like I don't know, what is the race issue going on here? Can you give us a clue?
Yeah, old white guy who's lived in the same neighborhood forever, suddenly people of other races move in, and some of them are gangbangers, and he f***ing hates them, but he ends up befriending one of them. And, you know, friends become enemies, enemies become friends, everyone's a little richer for the experience. Okay. I mean, it's a typical hero's journey kind of movie, but it's a stunning movie. It's really, 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 really good.
Okay, okay. And you co-sign whatever the message is? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So the message isn't all these brown people are taking over our cities, we must ban hip-hop and throw them in cages?
Well, part of it is that he learns that not everybody of the other race is bad. And then he kills the people that are bad, so...
Right. But because they're bad, not because... He kills them for the right reasons.
Okay. Right. And he doesn't really kill them, but it's kind of complicated. I don't want to spoil anything. But there's another movie I want to recommend, which is called Source Code. There's a couple movies by that name. It's the one directed by Duncan Jones, the same guy who directed Moon.
Yeah, yeah. Which is a great movie. That was one of our previous homework assignments.
I will also give that as a homework assignment. Source Code. It's not as amazing of a movie as Moon, but Moon is so amazing that a movie that's almost as amazing as it is worth watching. Mm. It's a lot more of a standard kind of psycho thriller. It deals with a lot of the same things that Moon deals with, like questioning what it really means to be human, isolation, death, serving your country, as whether that's worth it or not, whether the country appreciates it or...
Or whether you're just a tool in their games.
Yeah, basically, the country of America kind of takes the same moral place that the corporation in Moon takes.
Okay, okay.
If that makes sense.
No, that makes sense.
Yeah.
One overarching establishment power that seems to have omnipotent, evil, malevolent control.
Yeah, and tricks you into thinking one thing when they're really getting you to do another thing and not caring about you.
Which seems to me to speak really well to us liberty people, because that's sort of what the government feels like, you know, everywhere. Everywhere they look like this omnipotent, malevolent force, and it's almost like they are. I mean, it is like they are. I don't know why I said almost.
It's very similar to Moon in a lot of the motifs, but not the plot. And it deals with an interesting question that's kind of like Ethics 101 of, is it okay to sacrifice one person to save a million or to maybe save a million? And it does not answer that question. But that question is a important part of the plot in
this. Okay. I like it when movies don't answer the question. I like it when they set the question up and you are forced to think about the question.
And I really liked another thing about this movie, too, was that there's a mad bomber in it, and you meet him, and the hero asks him why he's doing what he's doing, and his answer, there's no way to discern any affiliation of his, you know, he's not a crazy Muslim, he's a white guy, but he doesn't seem like...
He's not somebody the SPLC would go after.
Right. I mean, they would if they were moral, but...
He's not that stereotype, though.
You know, his answer is basically, the world is evil... It needs to be rebuilt from the rubble, but first we need rubble. And that's why he's doing what he's doing. And there's no, like, political, there's no Tea Party, there's no gun nut, there's no, you know, he's just a crazy guy with a bomb. And there's no, like, affiliation. And Hollywood so often tries to put an affiliation on bad guys.
Well, that's important point, too, because that picks it apart. Because so often we blame the cause on the violence when we should be blaming the violence itself. I mean, if you're going to believe in radical Islam but never hurt anybody and just keep it to yourself, then there's no problem there, is there? No matter what you believe, and if you are a God-fearing Christian or somebody who other people might say, yeah, I agree with that position, if you want to blow people up for it, then that's where the problem is.
Yeah, and it's getting to the point where even believing anything or like having contact with people can get you in trouble. I talked to a friend recently, and I'm not surprised that he was contacted by the feds over either of these things, but he said that the day before, and he's not a bad guy, he's not a violent guy, he has no insider knowledge of anything.
Right. You co-sign him. He's
totally, yeah, and I know him. And this is totally coincidental, but he, the night before 9/11, the night before November 11th, 2001.
September
11th, 2001. He was in a bar, and he was just kind of drinking a little bit, talking to some strangers, and shooting the shit. And he said something to the effect of, people in America think they're safe, and they're really not. I mean, the thing is, it depends on whether someone's willing to die, you know, sacrifice. I mean, it's hard for them to do anything if they're going to try to get away with it. But if they're willing to die, I mean, someone could hijack an airplane and fly it into the White House. He said that in a bar, just being a guy like in a bar talking shit. And after the Twin Towers were blown up, the bartender was like, who the f*** was that guy? Went back to his bar, opened his bar, you know, when it was closed, looked through the receipts, got the guy's credit card receipt, and called the FBI.
Yeah, of course.
And the next day, they showed up at my friend's house and talked to him for about 9 hours.
I'm just
hours.
So surprised he didn't get thrown in Guantanamo right then and there.
I know. Well, it goes further than that. About a month later, they came to him and had photos of him from a security camera on the other side of the country in California of him sitting in a strip club between two of the hijackers.
Like the real hijackers.
Like the real
like
hijackers.
Like the dudes who were chilling with Muhammad Atta hijackers.
Right. Like he didn't know them. He was just, you know, sitting between them at a strip club. At the bar, he said he remembered them because they smelled really bad, like they didn't use
deodorant.
That's
racist.
Is that true of Middle Eastern people at all, in general?
I don't know. I always took offense to that stereotype because I think some people just smell regardless of their race, you know. There's stinky white kids, stinky black kids, stinky Mexican kids.
A lot of white anarchists in Europe smell. I think either they live in squats where there's no running water, or I've met ones in America, in Philly, who basically think that stinking is a political act.
See, and the other thing why I don't think it's racist, and this is maybe racist to say it back, but I know that cleanliness is a very important thing in Islam. That's why if you've ever had Muslim friends or friends that were born or raised near the Middle East, they hate dogs because dogs are dirty. They're scared of dogs. They'll recoil. And the thing about praying five times a day is you literally have to wash yourself. You can't pray and have any dirt on you. It's haram.
Okay, so is it racist that he said to me and I'm saying to you that these guys smell?
No, it was an observation. Yeah.
Yeah. Was it racist for me to wonder why Muslims were in a strip club?
No, that's not either, because that's coming at it from some sort of, oh, well, I know that, you know, it would also, not only would it be a haram to not clean, but also, obviously, to go look at women's boobies.
Well, maybe they wanted to see a naked woman before they went to meet their 72 virgins.
They wanted to know what they were getting into.
Yeah, see if it was
although
worth
you it. Ain't going to find no virgins at a strip club.
Yep. All right.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends Podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's freedomfiends.com.
Rolling.
Shall we roll?
So I read a great comment about SOPA from a couple weeks ago. It came from an official Chinese reporter, which basically means the government of China writing it.
Yeah.
You know what the Great Firewall of China is, right? It's the Western nickname for their internet censorship.
Right.
They said, the Great Firewall of China turns out to be such a visionary product that the American government is trying to copy us.
This isn't from The Onion?
No, it's not from The Onion.
Okay. I'll take your word for it. I'm going to go look that up myself, though. That's hilarious. Any other great gems from that article?
No, that was just the one that stood out, man.
Wow. I didn't realize until after we'd done the last cast that the Senate's counterpart, you sort of had a running joke that, you know, SOPA is not a delicious Mexican dessert. I didn't realize until after that the Senate version was called PIPA. So literally it's SOPA PIPA. So it's almost SOPIA.
So I guess that was intentional. I didn't know it.
Yeah, it was art imitating life or something like that.
So I've had some dreams lately. I don't usually remember my dreams, but I've had some that are so disturbing and violent that I think I'm not going to say on the internet what they were.
You always were a dreamer. So you're just teasing the fiends now.
Well, okay. I'll say them.
You don't have to, man. It's up to you. Maybe pick one. We don't need to harangue people with all four of these.
Okay.
Pick the most violent, despicable, insane, scary
dream. No, this is not the most violent one, but it's maybe the most telling. I had a dream that I went to an anarchist convention, but it turned out to be like a lefty anarchist, you know, syndicalist anarchist convention. And I had this boombox with me, like I brought to play some tunes for people. And I set it down. I was talking to some people and I turned around and my box was gone. And I looked around and this girl was taking it up to like where they had their PA system to like plug it in and play some stuff through it. And I went up to her and I was like, hey, that's mine. You know, I'd let you use it, but you should ask me first. And she said, oh, there's no property here. This belongs to everybody now. It belongs to us. It's not yours.
They were anarchists in the sense that we just need a very planned state without any property, and then we won't have a government. Yay.
They were anarchists in the sense of, we don't need a government to steal for us. We'll do it directly.
There you go.
And I was like, no, man, you got to give it back. And these like five dudes that were bigger than me all kind of like started to advance on me and like get up in my face. And I was about to pull my gun out and say, give me my fucking box back. And then I woke up. Okay. And that's really mild compared to... I'll tell another one of the dreams, too. I had a dream that...
Well, hold on. I do want to point out an inconsistency in your previous dream there. See, what? In real life, you would probably be happy that she was going to give your sound system some better speakers by plugging it into the PA. And audio quality is important to you.
No, I think if someone robbed me, I'd probably pull a gun on them and say, give me my back.
She was just helping your sound better, though.
So the second night, I had a dream that there was a bear coming through the bedroom window. DJ was asleep. I was awake. I saw the bear through the window, like sniffing at the window and trying to scratch and get in. And then it broke the window. And I was like grabbing DJ. She was like barely awake. And I was pulling her out of the room. And then I slammed the door and I went and got a rifle. And I went and got a FAL, which I don't even have anymore. But that's like...
You had at one point, though. And that's...
Yeah. And I think that's the thing I'd want to have in my hand if I were... Facing a bear,
yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I'd want a bolt action with five shots of Mosin, even though it's a little more hefty. I'd want to be able to shoot 20 shots in rapid succession of 308.
Yeah.
And then I shut the door, and I realized that the cats were still in the room. So I opened the door, and the bear was like halfway in the window by then, and I...
You woke up before you opened fire?
Yeah, I got one of the cats out. I was getting the other cat out, and I was about to shoot the bear, and then I woke up, and... The next night, I dreamt that I was hanging out with Dave Grohl, and he was telling me how great Pink Floyd is and how he was writing a celebrity version of You and the Police by Boston Tea Party. So I took one night off from violence, and then I think I got fed up with like being ready for self-defense but not doing it, and then the fourth night, I don't even want to talk about the dream, man.
Hold on, being ready for self-defense but not using it. Do you want to elaborate on that?
Well, I woke up before I pulled my gun to get my box back when these guys were advancing on me. And it was, you know, it was pulling my gun because guys were advancing on me.
Yeah.
It wasn't because of property crime. You know, that's not legal or ethical.
Right. There is some tension there, though, that I do understand, and maybe there is something to talk about there, to where it is very important to be ready to use self-defense. You know, that's part of self-preservation. It's the ultimate act, I think, of maturity and control to realize that you never want to use it.
Right.
And that's where the tension comes from. So you have to be responsible enough to realize that this isn't something I hope I never use, even though I feel that physical desire to play it out in my head.
I guess the takeaway that I'll give from this is I don't think that it's unnatural or crazy once you get into being prepared for self-defense and being armed, to have dreams or thoughts. You know, it's not fantasies. It's not like I'm waking up with a boner from this stuff. I woke up disturbed from this stuff. But,
right.
You know, it's kind of playing through your head the possibility. Okay, I'll tell the dream I had the fourth night. I think I was sick of, like, waking up before I had a chance to do the self-defense. So in this dream, if you want to skip something really gross, skip this. Go ahead about 2 minutes. I dreamt I was hanging out at someone's house and we heard a commotion and we went downstairs and someone had been hanged from their stairs. Like, and then their head had been chopped off by the rope and their head was hanging. I went down and I was trying to like take the head down. I don't think it was to put the head back on the body. I think I knew that was impossible, but just out of respect for the person or whatever.
Get him off of the rope, right?
Yeah, and he was like, it was screwed in at the top, and I grabbed a screwdriver, and I was trying to, like, unscrew this thing on a little hill, and I was looking into the face of this head, severed head, like, inches, you know, a foot away while I was unscrewing this and reaching above it, and then the head, the eyes looked to the left and looked really, and the mouth looked really horrified, and I looked to the left, it was warning me. There was this, like, old woman, kind of like a witch, you know, somehow like a movie witch, coming at me to, like, try to stab me. And I took the screwdriver and stabbed her in the ear repeatedly in her brain until she died.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So.
Well, you were defending yourself. See,
I was totally defending myself.
See, dreams are weird like that, though, because usually dreams, and I think that's notable, because most of the time when I dream, before the important thing happens, I wake up. And that's what happened in your previous dreams. Like, in my dreams, usually when it comes to self-defense, I have a gun, but somebody ends up either being bulletproof, or they've got a bigger gun, before my gun jams, but before they kill me, I wake up.
I've had those kind of dreams. The naked at school gun dream is what we call them. Mm-hmm. And I've had dreams where I'm in a self-defense situation and I'm about to practice self-defense and then I wake up. I think what this was after two of them in a row, it was lucid dreaming. I think I basically said, no, I'm going to stick this one through.
Yeah, yeah.
And I didn't have a gun on me, but I had the screwdriver on me.
Right.
And it was really graphic and really f***ed up and not fun.
Right, right. But it's interesting that that barrier was crossed, because even like with sex dreams, I never have a sex dream where I actually get to, you know...
Really?
Do what you do at the end of sex.
I get laid all the time.
No, I have sex dreams, but I don't get to, you know...
Oh,
to
squirt? I do that.
You do in your dreams, and then you wake up and you gotta go clean yourself?
Oh, no, I don't... I don't actually... I've only had like one... nocturnal emission, I guess they're called, in my life.
Mm-hmm.
I guess because I empty myself so frequently, or someone empties me for me.
That's my philosophy as well.
In my dream, I've consummated, shall we say, finished.
Uh-huh.
But when I wake up, I'm turgid, but not moistened. Did we just lose like half of our radio syndicators?
We did, but we gained like 50 old ladies.
Okay. All right.
With the use of the word turgid, that's going to increase our SEO there, Michael.
Moving right along.
Yes, we won't speak of that again. I'm glad we told people to wait and skip.
Yeah, because, okay. Now, this is the point where you can come back in and enjoy the family-friendly Freedom Fiends.
Yes.
So, Joseph Alaviro said, I have a new favorite hobby on Maui. I listen to Freedom Fiends in my car, pick up hitchhikers, and make them listen to it.
For real? And, that is so dope. Who said that?
Joseph Alivero. Oh, Alaviro.
Props, man. And nice balls there for willing to pick up hitchhikers.
Yep. And he said he's trying to think of other ways to spread Freedom Fiends. And I said, how about a USB drive in a bottle thrown in the ocean? And I said, though, it'd probably get the EPA kicking in my door.
And his door. See, and that's funny. It's like pulling up to people on the side of the road saying, hey, you want to catch the Freedom Fiends?
Yep.
What is that? Some kind of STD?
So the Casper Star Tribune, I mean the Prairie Pravda reports that the co-chairman of the Joint Education Committee wants to raise the compulsory attendance age to 18 years old and create a new law stating that if a child wants to drop out of school before 18 or before completing the 12th grade, they may do so with the parents' approval, but they will not be able to have a Wyoming driver's license.
Ooh, the power to license is the power to control, and see how they abuse it. So don't tell me that the government should be able to give out driver's licenses, because then they can do things like say, you must learn from our government indoctrinators no matter what. You can't go get a fucking job. If you quit, you have to stay home and be on house
arrest.
And
go on welfare.
Go on welfare.
I mean, basically, think about like in Wyoming where there's a lot of farms and ranches too,
mm-hmm.
where the family might economically need the kid to drop out of school at 16 and work full time for
the
family.
Right, and the kid's actually being productive when he works. Whereas when he's in the state school, he's only leeching money. Of course, the school district and the people lobbying for bills like this and rules like this, they don't see it that way. To them, they get money for every kid they have going to school.
That's what I think this is about. I think it's about federal funding.
Government funding of schools in general. There was recently a story, I forget out of what city, some Midwestern city, where they handed out every child's schedule to the cops in digital format. The cops had access to looking up what kids should be in school when. And they got the power to arrest kids who are truant and made a big deal out of going after these kids and taking them either back to school or back to jail. That's your two options. You get government jail A or government jail B. And part of the motivation was because the schools were losing funding. The less enrollment they have, the less they can show somebody was in school full time for a year, the less money they get. And the bureaucrats want to keep that gravy train chewing.
Yep.
F***ed up.
Like listening to the Freedom Fiends but want them to listen to you? Contact the Fiends at talkback@freedomfiends.com. That's talkback@freedomfiends.com.
So we have a comment from someone, a new listener who really likes us a lot. His name's Lance Sauer. said we could use his full name. He's a registered nurse, and he took exception to something you said. Let me read this. He said, I've been listening to your podcast for a while and find it very thought-provoking, a good stand on liberty. I sent my brother, who is a cop in Denver, a copy of Guns and Weed, and he will not talk to me about how drugs should stay illegal anymore.
Nice. I like that. I like that a lot.
On that, I'm very in favor of legalizing every drug to be able to be purchased freely without the government and or a doctor saying I can have it. At the end of your January 19th podcast, Neema said people should be able to get antibiotics without a script from a doctor. To that, I disagree. So basically, it sounds, if I'm reading this right, he thinks that crystal meth should be legal, but
antibiotics should not.
I don't know if that's what he's saying.
I think it's more nuanced than that. I think he gets into it a little bit more later.
He says, do you want to read some more?
Yeah, he says that when more people, and I've heard this argument before, and I've mulled it over in my craw, and I still got to take a stand, but maybe clarify it a little bit
more. Read his whole thing, and then I've got a comment, and then let's hear your take.
We'll finish it up. He says, when more people use antibiotics and use them inappropriately, the bacteria that the antibiotic is trying to kill. Basically, he's saying that the bacteria get a resistance, so that even now when people have to get a prescription, there is an increase in antibiotic resistance from the bacteria because it's so widespread. And so he says that's one of the reasons that penicillin isn't really prescribed anymore, because it doesn't work anymore.
He does say he doesn't care about people taking meth in their basement. They're not hurting anyone. But he says if someone takes basically what he's saying is that, like, freely using antibiotics, and I know that one thing that happens when antibiotics are available without a prescription is that people take them for things that antibiotics do not cure.
Mm-hmm. Like they'll have a virus and they'll demand an antibiotic.
Virus. They'll have a flu, right, and they'll take antibiotics, which do not do anything with viruses. But they do, the more people take them, the more often, the more society as a whole becomes immune to certain antibiotics and they have to move on to other ones. So basically, my take on this is I agree with him that people shouldn't take antibiotics like candy, but I don't think that the answer is government guns, which basically a prescription is government guns, because you're, you know, it's saying you have to go through a doctor to do it. If you don't, you're breaking a law. You know, if someone decides to sell antibiotics out of their home or give them to friends, I mean, it's illegal. Even, you know, if you have a prescription for antibiotics and then you don't need them, let's say, or they, you know, you're supposed to take all of them even when you feel better.
Right.
But let's say for some reason you have some antibiotics that were prescribed to you and you didn't use them, and you have a complete course of antibiotics, and you have a friend or a family member who needs antibiotics and you give them to them, you've broken a law. Basically, I'm saying I don't think government guns are the answer to this, but Neema, what do you think is the answer?
Well, see, I think it's important to point out that government guns don't really help the problem. I don't even think they're a very good stopgap at all. And I think the question is one of scarcity, and we have to view it through an economic lens, okay? So he's very right in the scientific fact that bacteria can become resistant. You know, bacteria, there's so many millions or billions of them that they evolve at a quicker rate than a species like humans. And so there's a finite amount that we can use said strategy of killing them, because eventually they'll become resistant to them. But the government or laws or regulations have never been good at helping the scarcity problem. They always make things more scarce. They make things worse. You wouldn't let the government, you know, decide how much coal to mine or how much oil to extract. So why would you let them decide how quickly bacteria becomes resistant? Now, the market has an inherent need for people to not die from bacterial infections. So new things will come along. The best thing at sorting that out is the market, not the government or regulations or things like a black market, to where you make selling antibiotics illegal if the proper licenses aren't obtained.
I think an answer for the free market would be something like Tupperware parties, where, like, people who studied all of it but aren't necessarily licensed by the state get together and analyze each other's symptoms and sell them.
Maybe. Okay, that's voluntary. There's nothing wrong with that. But it's important, like, you know, sometimes people, they get their prescription and they use it wrong anyway. They take four antibiotics and they put it in a drawer. And then a few weeks later, when they get sick again, they finish them off. You know, the government laws aren't going to change the way it works. So I think either way, in either scenario, whether you have to have a prescription or not, you're going to have people abuse it. So the solution then is to educate people. Say, hey, when you have a virus, antibiotics aren't going to work. Don't use them. Hey, use these antibiotics sparingly, you know?
You know, and I think it's possible that if you didn't have the big pharma government monopoly type regulation on things, people might have recombinant DNA labs in their garage and people might be able to come up with hundreds of new antibiotics weekly, and you know, when one stopped working, they'd come up with another one. Now the scarcity serves the big pharma to have a monopoly on having fewer of them.
Yeah.
So basically one thing it comes down to is
people being responsible for themselves. It's self-reliance.
It's not right to use government guns to protect people from being stupid.
Exactly.
Although this is an interesting thing.
The nuance
case
here is
study.
That it affects more people as a whole.
Right.
Right. There's a social thing there.
Most government gun stuff that people discuss is generally either way at the other end of the continuum or way at the big end of the continuum. It's either nanny shit that the government has no right to do, you know, or let's not even say government. People have no right to worry about other people doing.
There you go.
Like smoking weed in your house or having your fence 7 feet instead of 6 feet tall.
Yeah.
At the other end of that continuum would be like national defense. We need to go kill a bunch of people to protect these 300 million people, or so they say. This is kind of in the middle. It's kind of, it's not nanny. It does affect everybody, but it's not huge, huge affect everybody, maybe.
Maybe this guy would argue with you, though, and he would say, you know, we could have some kind of epidemic, and then what would we do? And my answer to that is we have those anyway, even with the government control. The government control doesn't really bring anything to the table. The root cause isn't that the government's not forcing enough people to not take antibiotics. The root cause is that people misuse it. And so address that problem. And you can do that best through social norms and education. I mean, people eat certain foods in other cultures over years because they were healthier. Society naturally figured out, and that became a part of the culture or a part of the tradition. The same thing with antibiotics. You know, mothers can tell their kids and teach their kids not to misuse antibiotics because it helps them too. They have a benefit and an incentive to use antibiotics properly.
I mean, I can think of non-governmental parallels. One would be the increased interest lately in eating healthy and disseminating information in eating healthy that happens outside of the government.
Of course, of course. And that's the beauty of the market is people find something that works. They inevitably want to share it to other people because there's a market incentive for them to do that, because if they become good enough at sharing and teaching, they can make money. And also because it makes people better. I think people naturally want other people to do well.
And another thing I could say is I think that just because someone has a medical license doesn't mean they're not complicit in overprescribing antibiotics to the point where they don't work.
Very good point.
An example is when I lived in San Francisco, after I got clean, I don't know what this was. I called it Dean syndrome because it was so weird. No one else really knew what it was or had the same thing. And it was like every 4 months, 3 or 4 months, I would get this, what felt like a really bad flu that did not have a temperature. You know, temperature was normal, but I had night sweats. I was lethargic. It lasted about 2 weeks and then it would go away. And I would generally go to this like clinica in my neighborhood in San Francisco, and this doctor would prescribe antibiotics for me. And I took them and I was assuming they were working, but after like 10 or 20 courses of this over several years, one time I didn't go and get antibiotics and it went away in the same amount of time. Mm-hmm. You know, which leads me to think it was a viral thing and it was going away at the end of 10 days of antibiotics because it would have gone away anyway.
Yeah, yeah,
you know?
Exactly. Big pharma. I mean, there's a whole job description of people whose job it is to represent people who make drugs and go sell those drugs to doctors. They take them out to nice steak dinners and wine and dine them. And then they basically, the agreement is the doctors will push their meds.
Yeah. I don't know that that was the case in this case because it was
it was a clinica.
It was a poor doctor with poor clientele and giving generic versions of medicine. So
right, right. But either way, the doctor generally has an economic incentive to give you medicine, right? I don't know. I feel like part of being a full-grown adult person is you have to be responsible for your own health. And I think too often people just rely on doctors. They outsource it. They say, hey, they give themselves over freely. They get naked. They let somebody else touch their body and tell them what to do with it. And I think it's an important thing. And I think that that's the way it would generally work in LibPair, is people would take more personal responsibility for their own health.
Is your neighbor would feel you naked and tell you what to do?
You feel yourself and tell yourself what to do. If you needed a neighbor, they would do it. Or if you needed to pay somebody to do it, that'd be fine. There's nothing wrong
with it. You hold your iPhone up to your
There you go. And you send it off to Google and Google school would mandate a course of antibiotics for you.
Yeah. Well, I was personally harmed by antibiotics. When I was a kid, they gave me tetracycline for lung infection, which was a new drug at the time. It's generally considered safe. I've been given it many times as an adult. But they didn't know, since it was a new drug, that if you take it before your adult teeth grow in, it discolors them when they in your head, and then they grow in dark. And my teeth are dark. And I'd looked into suing to try to get this paid for so I could get my teeth fixed, and it was impossible. It was like, no, the, you know, doctor this, doctor that, statute of limitations, etc. You know, there was no way to get it taken care of by the people who did it to me.
Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. That's a great example. I mean, the system, and that's a good argument for anybody who claims some kind of state rules need to be necessary, is it doesn't work now. The burden of proof is on you. It's not to say, hey, you know, the burden of proof is on you. You must say, prove that without a government, life would be better. No, we have a government right now. Life is horrible. You prove to me why we need a government, why it's necessary.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and the FDA has approved lots of drugs that have killed people, and they've later unapproved them, like Vioxx.
Vioxx, Fen-Phen, in Arrested Development. Take your fun.
Yes.
You're listening to the Freedom Fiends podcast, available from freedomfiends.com. That's FreedomFiends.com.
So what's the news, Neema?
The news, check this out. Snoop Dogg got arrested for pot in the same county that they also arrested Willie f***ing Nelson.
Willie f***ing Nelson, would that be Texas?
Yeah, yeah, it's Hudspeth County, Texas, arrested by the Sheriff's Department. You know, the DOGG, he freely admitted that he had three, actually, prescription bottles filled with joints. Of course, in the CNN story, they call them marijuana cigarettes. I rolled up the marijuana like a cigarette and smoked it.
I know what that's from.
Yeah, it's from
But I don't want to finish each other's sandwiches, so
no.
Go ahead.
Yeah, and this is the same exact stretch of highway where they also busted Willie Nelson in 2010 for pot. And get this, the county attorney, he said, you can bet your ass I'm not going to be mean to Willie Nelson. But they still forced him to pay the $100 fine. They actually told Willie he could get out of it if he'd serenade the court with the song Blue Eyes Crying in the Rain. Sing for us. If you want your marijuana, you
dance,
must sing for us.
Dance. I think it's funny how, like, they were afraid to throw the book at Willie Nelson because he's so popular there.
Yeah, yeah. We'll see what I mean, Snoop Dogg is sort of a pop culture icon outside of, you know, just hip-hop nowadays, I think, outside of Texas. Yeah, so I don't get it. Why even try to arrest people who you know smoke pot and are famous? I hope we get a song out of this. And also, I was enheartened by Snoop Dogg freely admitting that he had the pot. I remember the only time I ever saw Snoop Dogg in concert, it was this, what was the name of the tour? I forget the name of the tour, but it was Snoop Dogg, Jay-Z, 50 Cent. I went to see him in Salt Lake City. It was like one of the best rap shows ever. Jay-Z was awesome. Snoop Dogg had a live funk band back him up. Snoop Dogg, he pulls out this giant blunt on stage and just starts lighting it up. And he looks at the cop and he says, "Are you gonna come bust me for this? I'm gonna smoke this right here," and he blew it in the cop's face. And all I can think of now is Horizontal Liberation. You know, that cop was not gonna do shit. He just stood there and watched Snoop Dogg do his set.
Well, you know, performers doing things like that on stage is nothing new. I mean, Jim Morrison was arrested in the early 70s for showing his weenus on stage in Florida and, you know, did some, like, grabbed one of the cops' hats and put it on and was calling them pigs over the microphone. And they screwed him to the wall for it, though, man.
Did they?
Yeah.
Well, see, in this case, at the concert, the cops didn't do shit. They just let him finish his set. But I really hope that Snoop Dogg gives us a song about this and f***ing disses Hudspeth County, Texas sheriff for being such dicks.
You know, and it goes back to the thing that we cover in the movie of how, like, the state laws are different for marijuana and guns.
Right. I mean, perfectly law-abiding in one section, and then, A, who is anybody to tell somebody else they can't smoke pot? But B, somebody who smokes pot on TV and has since you love the government so much, has a government permission slip to have it. I mean, just leave the guy alone. Leave us all alone. You know, don't just leave Snoop Dogg alone. Just leave everybody the f*** alone. How's that?
You know, I saw another marijuana interesting news story. A University of New Haven forensic scientist is setting up a national data bank for marijuana DNA. That will permit law enforcement to track where the drug originated from when an arrest is made. Why does the government always take things that could be good and use them for evil? I mean,
duh, it's the government. Why do you even have to ask that?
I'm being facetious. Yeah, I know. And it's a rhetorical question. It's
of
like,
course.
You know, a database for marijuana heredity would be a great tool for people who grow marijuana.
Yeah,
but why
yeah.
do they have to turn it into a, we'll use it to put guns at people's head and put them in the cage?
Perfect microcosm of the government. They hijacked anything that's useful and productive to their own uses because that's in essence what they are. They're a power-seeking parasite. It does have shades of 1984 where they explain that pretty much all actual science has stopped except for science in the efforts to make tyranny more efficient, you know.
Yeah.
Science on keeping the slaves in check and torturing the slaves when they get out of line, or spying on people to decide who's out of line so you can torture them.
Word.
And we see that on a daily basis. There was, what is it, in New York now. It was a mainstream news station. I think it might have been an ABC affiliate doing a story on the cops in NYPD now have this thing that it's basically like a porno scanner, but they can do it on the side of the road. So you don't have to go through anything. They can just point it at you and see you basically an image of your body.
See if you have a gun.
See if you have a gun.
They can see if you have a gun.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. And so basically, really, we need the horizontal liberation to really come into play against stuff like this. Because how many people out there really want to be seen like that from cops? How many people want to have what's inside of their clothes being shown to everybody all the time?
You know, I heard of an advancement in science that kind of blows the mantle of police forensic science out of the water. I saw it on a Law & Order Statist Victims Unit show, and I thought it was sci-fi, and I looked it up, and it's not. There's a lab in Tel Aviv, Israel, that has actually created a way to make fake DNA evidence where they can take, you know, like let's say they could get a hair of yours with a hair follicle on it, they can generate more of that DNA and then take blood that's your blood type and take the DNA out of that blood, and it's still the same blood type as yours, and insert your DNA into that blood, and it could be planted at a crime scene.
Wow.
And that just totally undoes, like, you know, fingerprints, DNA, and ballistics are pretty much the trifecta of police forensics and used as evidence to throw people in cages.
Here's the thing I was under impression about DNA, though. When I've covered crime stories and things like that, usually if I'm in court and the prosecution's trying to make a case about DNA, or even the defense is trying to refute it, the DNA, it's never like, this is 100% this person's DNA. It's always some level of probability. You know, they always have some match. Like, this person is, you know, a 1 in 1 million match. And even that'll play with a jury. Or a 1 in 100 match of DNA.
Well, so this could put a 1 in, you know, and it's often, it's like 1 in 6 billion or something. It's like often how many people there are in the world. And but this could put you at the scene of a crime, irrefutably, when you were not at the scene of a crime.
Wow. Wow. Yep, yep. And so that's a tool now. That's a tool for prosecutors to use. And not that they need it much anymore, because juries drop to their knees in front of prosecutors as it is, because as we were explaining the last cast, prosecutors basically get to pick the jurors. So they pick the ones that are most easily convinced. I guess defense lawyers have a say in it too. But there is that process where they get to pick the jurors, and a prosecutor's always going to push for the most easily sheeped people.
Did you read about the feds want to make it illegal to lie on the internet?
I think they've been trying that for a while. Is there a new bill or anything new on that?
Well, yeah, the Department of Justice was clamoring about it of, you know, basically what the government does 24/7, they want to make illegal to the point where it'd be so vaguely written that, you know, if you lied about your weight on a dating site, it could be a crime.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'd heard about them wanting to do that.
Which I think lying about your weight on a dating site is not a crime. It shouldn't be a crime. It's just stupid because the person's going to meet you if you're lucky, you know, and they're going to see you're not the weight you say you are.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know. I think the government's just ridiculous in every sense. And I think that's just another chance of them saying, hey, we want to regulate the internet, basically. And they try to attack these sort of pressure points that people have. So people might think that, yeah, I don't want to be defrauded. Of course, that's just the bait the government holds out in front of you. What they're really wanting is control, because then they use their vague wording, and it basically gives them carte blanche to do what they want.
Yep. You know, I was thinking about some of my early thoughts of the government is bad. You know, I've said that, like, one was seeing Richard Nixon quitting being president for getting caught.
Knowing who Richard Nixon is.
Yeah, you know, and another was watching the Vietnam War before that on TV. Another one I forgot about was when I was about six, seeing on the nightly news, you know, the national news, ABC, NBC, or CBS, one of those, because that's all that we had for TV back then.
Right.
Which you really can't wrap your mind around, can you? Like, when I was a kid, there were three channels.
Yeah, I don't know how that worked. That's insane to me.
I mean, we could get one Canadian channel sort of fuzzy. Yeah, so one of the first things that really made me think the government is bad was I saw on TV they had this news story of dairy farmers that were being paid by the government not to have enough milk, you know, like to have less milk.
Yeah,
it was a subsidy thing where they're paid not to sell milk.
Right.
The footage they had with it was about 10 dairy farmers standing around with those like 20-gallon old-style tall metal thin milk containers
just
that they'd
pouring
send
them out onto the ground,
pouring them into a sewer, you know, hundreds of gallons of milk. And this is like
how old
around the same time my parents and my teachers were saying, eat all your food because there's kids starving in other parts of the world.
Yep. My mom used to tell that to me too. There's kids starving in China.
And I'd always say, well, they can have my broccoli.
Yep. How old were you when you remember seeing this story?
Like 6 or 7. It was mind-blowing to me. It was like, wait, that's wrong.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
They're wasting food, and the government's paying them to do it.
Right. And that's why I often say that, yeah, kids can get it, because kids don't have the clouding of government schools telling them that if the central economic planners say something, then we need to use supply and demand the way the experts say it will work. And you remember back in, I mean, I not remember, but in the Great Depression, FDR's programs had people plowing over crops. You know, they talk about it in the Grapes of Wrath, farmers just, you know, throwing crops away because the government told them to, and the government was paying them. You had a better price.
I think the government got a lot of flack for this, because shortly after that is when they came out with government cheese. I think that it just was too bad of a press idea to have them showing on TV the farmers dumping the milk down the gutter, so they just made it into government cheese.
Right. And it's another important point to make that this is one of the reasons why subsidizing an industry is a horrible thing to do. And you always get the worst consequences of it. And farmers who take the government money, schools who take government money, any industry that takes government money is going to be expected to follow these government regulations and do things that the planners say, not things that the markets tell them. And it's bad for the producers, it's bad for the consumers, and it's bad for the economy as a whole.
And it's kind of getting to the point where in a lot of industries, you can't step outside of the monopoly of playing within the government's backyard.
Completely.
Tyranny in your neck of the woods got you yowling? Tell the Freedom Fiends about it at talkback@freedomfiends.com.
As a young American, or just as a young person, it really upsets me how whenever I have an idea of something I want to do in a business sense, you know, that is something you have to think about, and it really shouldn't be. You shouldn't have to think about what regulations do I need to follow, what government paperwork do I need to fill out. What you should be thinking about and spending your energy on is making your business better or making your idea better. Think about all the wasted opportunity cost and energy that goes into just following these mandates. It's an insane amount.
It crushes innovation too, especially since a lot of times the people that have the mind to innovate are not the people that have the mind to deal with red tape.
Oh, completely. Because people who have the mind to innovate, they want their brain stimulated, and filling out red tape is the most mind-numbing practice.
And, you know, generally the way it works is in a startup company, one guy does the innovation and the other guy does the red tape. But it's getting to the point where you need like 20 guys to do the red tape to support one guy innovating.
Right. So the innovator might as well just, I don't know, innovate his own shit and I guess not have to deal with the government. But then, you know, if he does that to the extent that he starts to make money, the government inevitably comes in and takes it away.
And, you know, I mean, part of it might be a backdoor way of trying to get the innovators to just give up and go work for the government.
Oh, I completely think so. And not just work for the government, but play within the rules to where the government is feeding off them enough.
Go work for the government to where the government owns any technologies you come up with. And of course, they'll just use them to throw people in cages more efficiently.
Of course, of course. Yeah, I mean, I think the government's ultimate dream would be to have everybody be an employee of the state. To have it to where every economic interaction was between the state and a state operative. That way they would have complete and total control. That is their, that is obviously their dream. And that's what they're working towards.
And, you know, the Republicans always point fingers at the Democrats and say, you know, the Democrats are following Saul Alinsky's playbook and blah, blah, blah. And they're communists and they want the government to control everything. And then the Republicans just turn around and try to control everything, too, in different ways and in some of the same ways.
Right, right. All politics seems to be really about is hitting the right pressure points for people, scratching the right crazy cat spots.
Well, you know, a quote, going back to quote of the week, Liberty quote of the week, I've been quoting a lot to a lot of people of what Larkin Rose said in your interview of all politics is arguing about who should be on the throne when we should really be arguing about why should there be a throne.
Yeah, yeah. That's what we should be arguing, and inevitably we'll win that argument. That's why they don't want us to argue about that. That's why they go through so much effort to make sure we're arguing about who should be on the throne. Because if we ever did have a national argument on whether or not there should be a throne.
You know, the place where Ademo got arrested for filming is a public high school where he had previously been chased off by the principal for handing out cop block literature and t-shirts and things like that. So I think that they had it in for him because he was trying to disindoctrinate the kids from the public school bullshit.
Oh, yeah. I completely believe that. The local government bullies there know who the Free Staters are at this point. I have to respect the way Ian and that whole crew over there has made that sort of a front line in the battle for liberty.
Yep.
Because it's such an amorphous thing.
And
they hate him completely. I mean, I think Ian, last I heard, was pretty much banned from the courthouse. You know, unless he has written consent or official business there, he's not allowed to be at the courthouse.
Is that legal?
No, I don't think it's legal by any stretch. I don't think it's legal by their rules either.
But, that's what I mean.
But who does Ian have to get to say it is legal? He has to get one of those government people who are the keepers of the law to say it's legal. So if he wants to challenge it, he still has to wait for the procedure to go through, and he has to hope that the people who control the government are going to, for some reason, side against themselves and in favor of truth and Ian, which that's a long leap to make.
Yeah. Worms.
Worms, homie.
What else you got?
Nothing I can think of that was particularly pressing on me. Any other liberty news in your head, Michael?
I can't see any.
All right. Well, we'll take that as good news. Not that there, not that there isn't extra tyranny out there that we're not covering, but I think it's still a happy day for liberty.
Yeah.
As it always is, because we're still here podcasting instead of sending out carrier pigeons with flash drives taped to their backs.
Yes. Yes. They'd probably get fried by the solar flares too.
What's this solar flare shit?
Or in Wyoming, they just get blown into a building and killed. There's a solar flare event happening right now from the sun, which is affecting telecommunications in the Earth to the point where they've had to reroute some commercial airlines near the North and South Pole, and it's affecting cell phones and things like that.
I see. I see. How long is it supposed to last?
A couple more days.
Okay. Should be interesting. Are we expecting a bigger flare in the future?
No, it happens every few years, but this is the biggest one in several years.
Right, okay. But this is supposed to be the big one. I remember hearing talk of people saying there was going to be a big solar storm sometime in 2012. Is this the big one they were referring to, or is this just part of it?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. It's not going to fry all your electronics, but it is making some things work strangely.
Okay. Fair enough. So,
all right.
Survive the solar flare and download Freedom Fiends and listen to it, and you'll be okay.
Worms.
Peace.
Hello, Freedom Fiends. It's your boy, Dean, from the U.S. Get the U.S. out my bloodstream. I-O-E, and that includes endorphins. No one won't ask permission, and I won't say please. Freedom fans, one fact that I gotta make clear.
The Freedom Fiends podcast is covered by a Creative Commons Attribution Share Alike 3.0 license. Do what you want with it and spread it around.
Tell two friends. Make copies. Email it to everyone you know. Go on the site and comment. This is a conversation. Every week, we'll have an exciting new episode where Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi weave their own unique take on the way the world works and how to find your place in it. Available from freedomfeens.com. That's freedomfeens.com.
Freedom Fiends is proudly syndicated by alterati.com, the Micro Effect Radio Network at themicroeffect.com, and the Liberty Radio Network at lrn.fm.
Subscribe and tell two friends.
And remember, the only power they have is the power you allow them.